Hello, one and all. My name is IAS Venugopal. I am working as assistant professor in the Department of Information Technology. So today, now I am going to present a lecture on multi-threading. So before starting multi-threading, I want to tell you something regarding multitasking. So what is multitasking means the name itself indicates. Whenever you want to perform multiple tasks at a time, that kind of concept is called as multitask. The best example of multitasking is our operating system itself. See, if you observe, in my operating system, I have opened a browser. Simultaneously, I can open a PPT, PowerPoint presentation. I can open a Microsoft Word document. Similarly, at the parallelly, I'm also able to present the material to you. So whenever you are able to perform more than one task at a time, that kind of concept is called as multitasking. Strictly speaking, in computer science, we'll be calling each task as a process. So multitasking is basically, it is of two kinds. First one is multitasking and another one is multitasking can be done in two ways, multi-threading and multi-processing. So multi-processing means each process is nothing but an application or a program. So whenever you are able to execute more than one application, or whenever you are able to run more than one application or one process at a time, that kind of concept is called as multi-processing. So the best example of multi-tasking is, or multi-processing is, your Windows operating environment or any operating system. Why? Because parallelly you'll be able to run more than one task or more than one process at a time. That is the concept of multi-processing or multi-tasking. Coming to multi-threading. So multitasking or multi-processing means executing more than one process at a time. Coming to multi-threading. Say for example, multi-threading, the best example is, now I am opening a Word document. In this Word document, I'll type something. This is class regarding multi-threading. See, as you can observe, while I am typing, parallelly, the Microsoft Word document will have a word checker. What this word checker will do means, it will parallelly check for the errors. This kind of tasking is called as multi-threading. Multi-threading means under the same application or under the same process, you are able to run different threads within the same process. So a process can be divided into different threads. Each thread does a specific task. For example, I am typing. This is one task. For example, see, whenever I am typing, it is one task. Parallelly or concurrently, another thread is running that checks for the spelling mistakes in the Word document. This kind of activity is called as multi-threading. Multitasking, or strictly speaking, multi-processing means running more than one application or more than one task at a time. For example, running browser, running Microsoft Word document, running Microsoft PPT, it is multi-processing. Multi-threading means within an application, you are able to run more than one thread at a time. For example, here in this thread, I am typing. Parallelly, it will check for the errors. See, for example, typing. I didn't type it G. Whenever there is any typing mistake, it will immediately give an error. See, whenever the mistake is removed, the red line will be removed. Multi. See, parallel, I'm able to edit within a document, and the Microsoft spell checker will check for spelling mistakes. This kind of tasking is referred to as multi-threading. Within an application, multiple threads will run. See, parallelly, while typing itself, I can issue the print command. So all these things can be done concurrently or parallelly. So whenever you are able to run multiple threads within a application, that is called as multi-threading. Remember, multi-threading refers to within an application, within a process, you can create multiple threads. Another example, you can consider a Windows media player or any media player. For example, you are trying to listen to music. So you have added some songs to the library. And you want to listen to those songs. The songs can be played one by one after the other, or the songs can be played in a random order. So by listening to the songs, what you can do means you can add the songs, you can remove the songs, and you can shuffle the songs. All these can be done while listening to the music. So listening to the music will be one thread, adding files to the Windows Media Player will be another thread, removing songs another thread. A thread that takes care of shuffling of the songs or which song to be played next, for that another thread will be used. So multi-threading means different threads that are part of a individual process, of a single process. So within a single process or application, if you are able to perform more than one task at a time, that concept is called as multi-threading. So in Java, we'll be creating thread concept to create multi-thread. So multi-threading means running more than one task at a time within an application. Within a process, you'll be dividing your entire process or entire application to different subtasks, within which every subtask is carried by a thread. So for example, consider an application is there. I'll be dividing it to three parts, part one, part two, and part three. Each part is called as a subtask. Subtask 1 can be carried out by thread 1, subtask 2 can be carried out by thread 2, subtask 3 can be carried out by thread 3. Hence, it improves the efficiency of the processor. So that is the main advantage of multi-threading. So as I already told you, multi-threading, it is a process of executing multiple threads simultaneously. Whenever you are able to execute more than one thread at a time, it is called as multi-threading. A thread is a lightweight process. I will tell you why it is called as a lightweight process. So it is the smallest unit of processing. Within a process, the smallest unit is called as a thread. Multi-processing and multi-threading, these are the two kinds of multitasking techniques. Multitasking means doing more than one task at a time. In multi-processing, you can run multiple applications. Using multi-threading, you can run more than one task within an application. Within an application, you can divide the application into different tasks, wherein which every task can be carried out by a different thread. So where you need multi-threading? See, for example, have you ever faced this situation? So whenever you face this type of situations, you will be in some sort of shock. You will be in a shock. For example, your browser will not allow you to move to the next page because it is downloading a file. See, for example, in a browser, if you observe, you can open multiple tabs. Within each tab, you can browse a different website. What if you are downloading a file and the browser doesn't allow you to move to the next tab? Without multi-threading, it would have been difficult. Similarly, you cannot enter text in the text document or word processor while the document is being saved to the disk. While in the process of saving the file to the disk, if you are unable to enter the content in a word document, it is also difficult. It would have been difficult. So to perform all these tasks, you will be needing multi-threading. So as I already told you, multi-threading and multi-processing fall under the category of multi-task. So multitasking, name itself indicates, you'll be able to execute more than one task at a time. Multitasking is a process of executing multiple tasks simultaneously. So we use multitasking to make maximum utilization of the CPU, that is processor. So the main role or duty of an operating system to make sure that the processor is not kept idle. The processor is very, very important in our operating system. We have to make sure that always some application program is being run by the processor. So this can be achieved by two ways: process-based multitasking, which is also called as multiprocessing, and thread-based multitasking, which is multi-threading. All the modern operating system, they support multitasking. You will be able to run more than one application at a time, and every application can have multiple threads running in parallel. So already I explained this process-based multitasking. So the best example of multi-processing means process is nothing but an application or a program. So in your computer system, if you are able to parallelly edit a Word document and playing the music and browsing the net, it can be considered as a multi-processing. You are running more than one process or application at a time. Coming to thread-based multitasking or multi-threading. So in multi-threading, the smallest individual unit of execution is a thread. Multi-threading, multi-threads, more than one thread, if they are run by the operating system, it is called as multi-threading. So in multi-threading, thread is the smallest piece of code that is being executed by the processor, that can be dispatched by the thread scheduler to be executed by the processor. So a single program can perform two tasks using two threads. So within a single program or within an application, if you perform more than one task at a time, if you perform more than one task concurrently, it is called as multi-threading. So whenever you create multiple threads, all those threads, they share the same address space. Hence, threads are called as lightweights. So whenever you want to run any application or process in your operating system, what happens means that application or process need to be loaded into the main memory, that is called as RAM. So different applications will have different memory. So for example, whenever you open Word, it will have some memory. Whenever if you open a browser, it will have some memory. Now I have opened PPT, it will have some memory. So in multiprocessing, different applications will have different memories. But whereas in multi-threading always refers to a within an application. So within an application, all the subtasks or all the threads, they can share the memory. Threads share the same address space, hence it is lightweight. Whereas process, they do not share same address space. They have dedicated memory space or dedicated address space. So those are heavyweight. Multi-threading is lightweight, multi-processing is heavyweight. Weight is lightweight means, for example, different threads want to communicate with each other. For example, in previous case, in Word document, while typing the content in the document, parallelly another thread is trying to read the text and check the text grammatically. So both these threads, they share the same address space. Hence, it is called as lightweight. Cost of interaction between the threads is low. Way because they use the same address space or shared address space. So this is a thread in a Java. For example, consider in every operating system, you can run more than one process, multi-processing. For example, in this case, there are three processes, process one, process two, and process three. In the example given, process one, within a process, within an application, you can create more than one thread. In this case, T1, T2, and T3. They work together and they share the same address space. See, process one has dedicated address space, process two dedicated address space, process three dedicated address space. But whereas the threads within a process, they share the same address space. So context switching between the threads is very easy. it takes less time. The service time is very less for context switching between different threads. Hence, threads are lightweight, processor heavyweight. So, for example, computer games are the best examples for multi-threading. Computer games are the best example for multi-threading. You will be seeing multiple players. You can play a game with multiple players, whether a car race or a bike race, there will be multiple players playing parallel in the same game. So there multi-threading is used. At the same time, it will display the time, it will display the speed. All these things are displayed within a same application. Hence it is multi-threading. This is another example. If one person paints, if you want to paint your house, if one person paints, it is single thread. If 10 people paint your house in 10 different areas, that is multi-threading. Remember, these 10 persons, they need to communicate with each other. They need to talk with each other to decide in which area they need to paint. That is called as interaction. So since all the people, they paint the same house, interaction is easy. Consider multi-processing as these 10 people paint 10 different houses. That is multi-processing. This is another example I already covered, Microsoft Word example. So multitasking versus multi-threading, or multi-processing and multi-threading. So multi-threading is lightweight, multitasking is heavyweight. Context switching in multi-threading is very easy. It is very difficult in multitasking. Multi-threading, different threads share the same address space. Multitasking, they have dedicated address space. So switching from one thread to another thread is very easy way because it is controlled by a thread scheduler. Whereas switching from one task to another task, it is decided by the process. So this is the difference between multitasking and multi-threading. So what are the uses of multi-threading? As already said, you will be able to perform more than one activity within a process or within an application at a time. Each activity or subtask that is being executed by the processor is referred to as a thread. Each activity can be carried out by a separate thread. So without multi-threading, in olden days, we need to have single-threaded systems. Single-threaded systems mean at a time, you will be able to run only one thread. Only single thread runs in an infinite loop. So whenever some other thread wants to run, so they will use a process called as polling. Polling indicates after this thread, which thread need to execute. It is similar to people standing in a queue to take tickets. For example, you want to take a book a bus ticket. You will observe the people will be waiting in a queue. That is a single-threaded system. There will be only one person who will be issuing the ticket. So remaining people have to wait until the first person takes his ticket. Next concept is life cycle of a thread. Life cycle of a thread means whenever a thread is loaded into the memory and it exits from the memory, what are the different states it takes? The different states of a thread is called as life cycle of a thread. So whenever an application need to be run, it need to be brought into the primary memory. So whenever an application is brought into the primary memory, that application will have different threads. So whenever a thread is started by the corresponding application or by the thread scheduler, it will have these five states: new, runnable, running, non-runnable, and terminated or exited. So these are the five different stages that are involved while a thread takes its birth until it dies. So this is a life cycle. So whenever a new application is brought into the primary memory, it will be in the new state. So whenever you want to start a thread, you have to use a method called as start. Start method, what it does means it loads the application that is there in the secondary memory to the primary memory. Then it is set to be in runnable. New, the thread is in new state if you create a new instance of the thread. But before invocation of the start method, it is in new state. So start method, what it does means, it loads the application to the primary memory and it waits for the CPU to be given turn to it. Whenever you want to execute any thread, the processor must be given to it. So it waits until the thread scheduler schedules the thread to be executed by the processor. So until and unless the CPU is given to the thread, it will be in runnable state. Then the thread scheduler, it schedules, it determines which thread next to be executed. So when the CPU turn comes to the thread, it comes under running. This will be decided by the operating system. Which thread to run will be decided by the operating system based upon its priority, all these things. So from runnable to running, running means the current thread is being executed by the processor. Similarly, you can move a thread from running to non-runnable state or blocked by calling this some set of methods. So we'll discuss this in the due course of concept. I can suspend a thread. A thread can wait until some other thread. Finishes its execution like that. Similarly, from non-runnable, it is also called as blocked mode. From blocked, again, the thread can move to a runnable state by calling some of these methods. For example, I can suspend a thread for 100 milliseconds. After 100 milliseconds, again, the thread moves to a runnable state. Remember, always thread moves from blocked to runnable, not running. Why? Because at a time, only one thread can be run. That is determined by the Java virtual machine or by your operating system. A component called as thread scheduler will be there in JVM that decides which thread to execute next. So once again it moves from block to runnable, the thread is waiting for the processor to be given to it by the thread scheduler. Finally, terminate. You can terminate a thread. A thread gets terminated when its job is over. So to handle multi-threading in Java, a multi-threading means running more than one thread at a time. So there is a thread class in Java to perform multi-threading. The thread class is part of the package java.lang. You know, java.lang is a default package in java.lang package is the default package available in Java. So java.lang is the default package available in Java. Inside the default package, thread class is defined. You know, every class will have constructors and methods. Constructors allow you or tell us how to initialize an object of that class. For example, I want to use a class. I need to initialize it. I need to create an instance of that class. So while instantiating, how you can initialize that object, that is determined by constructor. These are the different constructors available. First one is an empty constructor, no arguments passed to it. Second constructor is you can pass a runnable object. Third constructor, you can pass a runnable object followed by string name. I'll explain these constructors while writing the program. Four type of constructors, you can pass a string name. And fifth type of constructors, you can create a thread that is part of one group followed by the runnable object. And fifth one is you can create a thread that is part of a thread group, runnable interface and string name. These are the different constructors. I'll use these constructors while writing a program. Remember, whenever you want to initialize an object of thread class, you have to use this any of the constructor given. Mostly you'll be using 1, 2, 3, and 4. 1 to 4 constructs will be used. So whenever you want to create multiple threads that are part of one group, you can go for 5th and 6th constructors. So once constructs are explained, we'll be having the methods. not only thread class, any class in Java, they will have constructors and methods and properties. Constructors tell you how to initialize the object. For example, in this case, thread object, how you can initialize in different ways, how you can initialize the thread object. Similarly, methods. Using methods, you can perform various actions on the corresponding object. For example, the various methods defined in thread class are using methods, you can control the behavior of an object. So start, the name itself indicates, it is used to start the execution of a thread. So we have seen in the thread lifecycle, from new state, it moves to runnable by calling the start method. Run, whatever is the job of a thread or for which task you'll be creating a thread, the task code is written inside this run method. Whatever is the duty of the thread, the duty of the thread is need to be written inside this run method. So whichever you'll be writing the code inside that run, that will be executed by your JVM. For example, we'll be creating a thread to serve some purpose. What is the purpose of thread? What is the purpose of the thread? That functionality is written inside this run method. Similarly, sleep. Using sleep, you can suspend the execution of a thread for a specified amount of time. Then the thread moves from running to blocked mode or non-runnable. After expiration of that time, again it moves to runnable state. Similarly, current thread. Current thread returns a reference to the current thread that is being run by the JVM. Current thread returns a reference to the current thread. Similarly, join. What join method does is it waits for all the threads to die. This will be using during controlling the execution of a thread that I will explain the join method. Get priority. It is used to return the priority of a thread. Priority, separate lecture is there. Default priority of a thread is 5. You can set any priority values from 1 to 10. Default priority is 5. That is normal priority. Get name returns the name of the thread. Set name sets the name of the thread. Similarly, isAlive. isAlive is used to check whether the thread is active or not. Whether it is terminated or not. isAlive returns true or false, boolean value. Similarly, you can use suspend, resume, notify. All these methods I will discuss in synchronization. In synchronization, we'll get a notify, wait, all those methods. Similarly, suspend and resume, you can use while for inter-thread communication, you can use your suspend, resume, notify, wait. That I will discuss during inter-thread communication. These are the important methods of thread. So next topic is how to create a thread. So whenever I want to run more than one thread at a time, first I need to create a thread. Multi-threading means running more than one thread at a time. So how will you create a thread in Java? So there are two ways to create threads in Java. First one is by extending thread class. Second one is by implementing runnable interface. Both these are part of java.lang package. java.lang.thread class, you can extend that class. Otherwise, you can create a class that implements java.lang.runnable interface. I will tell you way there are two ways. So first way, creating a thread by extending a thread class. So how will you create a thread? By extending a thread class. So instantiate the class that extends thread. So first you have to, so whenever you want to create a thread by extending thread class, first you have to create a thread that extends from thread class. So I'll explain with the help of a code. So I'll open Notepad. For example, I'll write public class thread demo one extends thread. So there are two ways of creating a thread. First way is by extending class. So I have to create a class that extends from thread class. So first you have to create a class. You can give public class or class name extends thread. This is first way. So after declaring a class that extends thread, you have to create a class that need to override the method run. I have told you with whatever is the functionality of a thread, what is the purpose of a thread, the code that need to execute for that thread need to be written inside this run method. The code, what is the purpose of the thread? For example, I want to print system dot out dot println that is running. So for example, I will treat the functionality of my thread is running. So first you have to create a class that extends from thread class, then you need to override the method run. So the code that should run as a thread will be part of this run method. So next, what you have to do means we have to call that run method. Public static void main string and array of instances of strings. So we must call this run method. So in order to call this run method, we cannot call a run method directly. So to call that method, we have to use a method called as start. See, always remember, you cannot call the run method directly. Run indicates what is the functionality of the thread. When the thread is being executed, which code to run, what is the task. Actually, this code will be run when that thread is scheduled by the thread scheduler. So first I have to start the thread. So if you observe the thread life cycle, we have to start the thread demo equal to new space thread demo one. So this is how you will create. So I want to, so I'm creating an object to this class. After creating an object, see, remember, whenever you want to use the properties and methods of a class, you need to create an object. In this case, thread demo one. So I created an object. So now I need to start the thread. Thread demo dot. So you need to invoke using the start method of thread. You shouldn't write thread demo dot run. Start thread demo dot start. Then whenever the statement is executed by the JVM, it places the control inside the run method. And when the thread scheduler schedules this thread, then it will be executed. So these are the steps. First step is you have to create a class that extends from the thread class, and you must override the run method. So whichever code, whatever is the functionality of the thread, that functionality right inside the run method. Next, you have to invoke that run method by calling the start method. We must call the start method on this thread to make it run. So now I'll save this file. I'll save this file as. Since it is public class, the file name and the class name must match with each other. The file, the name with which the file is saved and class name must be the same in case of public class. So I saved the file. Now I'll open the command prompt. And I'll execute. It is in my desktop. Properties and increase the font size. So I'll compile the Java program, Java C space. Thread demo 1.java. The program is getting compiled. Now I need to execute Java space that demo one. So it is giving the output as thread is running. So I have created a single thread. And it prints thread is running. So this is how I'll create a thread. Now here the functionality is thread is running. Now I want to change its functionality. For example, I will change its functionality to, when I want to change the functionality, I need to change the keyword within run. For example, I want to print the values from 1 to 100. For example, I want to, the thread to print the values from 1 to 100. So I took a variable, I have initialized it. Now I'll write system.out.println that is running. Plus, I will print the value. So just I'm running a value here. The task of my thread is to run a value from 1 to 100. Thread is running 1, thread is running 2, like that. So I'll save it. Again, I'll compile it. So you can observe, it's printing the value from 1 to 100. So here what happens means, the same thread, it is printing the value from 1 to 100. Whichever other thread is there, it need to wait until it prints from 1 to 100. So within 1 to 100, if I want to execute some another thread in parallel to it, for that I need to create another thread, and both threads can execute parallelly. I'll write the next program how to create multiple threads. Then what happens means, the thread 1 and the thread 2, they will run concurrently. If they don't run concurrently, always it will be a single-threaded model. But I want multiple threads to run. It is multi-threading. So this is one way of creating the threads by extending the thread class. Now there is another way. The another way is, so before moving on with the another way, whenever you want to get a reference to the current thread, we'll be using a method called as current thread. So there is a method called as current thread. What it does is it returns a reference of the current thread that is being run by the JVM. So for example, there is a thread. If I write thread t equal to thread dot current thread, it will return a reference to the current thread. For example, in this case, the current thread is the main thread. Always remember, your main method is one thread. Always program execution begins from main method. Always main is treated as a one thread. So if I write thread dot current thread, it returns a reference to the main thread. If I print t, it will display the information regarding that thread. So for example, I want to print the information regarding a thread. So I'll name the class as thread info. You can give any name. So public static void main. In public static void main, what will I do means, just I will create a thread that returns a reference to the current thread. I'll create a thread that returns a reference to the current thread. The reference to the current thread can be retrieved by using current thread method. So thread dot current thread, what it does means it returns a reference of the current thread. Here the current thread is main thread. So I want to print public static. So if I want to print a reference of it, simply print system.out.println current thread. To print a reference, just print the t value. suspend out dot println current thread t. Let us see information regarding in the current thread. Now I want to change its name. To change its name, there is a method called as set name. For example, I want to change its name from default name to demo thread. System.out.println new name of thread. After changing the name, again I am printing its reference. See, similarly, whenever you want to execute more than one thread, in this case there is only one main thread. Along with it, if I want to run one more thread in parallel to it, actually I can induce some delay. I can induce some delay. The delay can be introduced by using the thread's sleep method. For example, thread.sleep of the sleep method accepts a parameter in milliseconds. I can pass an integer value in which treats it as milliseconds. For example, 1000 milliseconds equivalent to 1 second. So for the 1 second, the main thread will be suspended from its execution, and any other thread waiting for the processor will be executed. Like this, you can simulate multi-threading. So catch off. So actually, this sleep method, it throws a checked exception called as interrupted exception. So it has, checked exception. Checked exception means it compulsory need to be put in try catch block. Println main thread interrupted. So I'll save this as thread info. Control C, save as threadinfo.java. So I'll execute the program. Java C space threadinfo.java. As you observe, after name of thread is printed, it is giving some gap. That gap is created by this thread.sleep. What thread.sleep does means it suspends the current thread that is being executed by the processor and makes the thread to go into blocked mode or non-runnable state, so that any other thread waiting for the processor can be executed. See, always in multi-threading, most of the materials, they will use this try catch block. They will use this thread.sleep of 1000. That thread.sleep of 1000 is used to illustrate multi-threading in a single processor environment. In a single processor environment, there will be only one processor. So while one thread is being executed, remaining thread needs to wait. So to illustrate that multiple threads execute concurrently, this thread.sleep is used. It suspends a current thread that is being executed, and another thread can be executed within this 1 second to make maximum utilization of the CPU. Concurrent threads means they can run in parallel, one after the other. So this thread.sleep of 1000, the main thread will be suspended for 1 second, and another thread can run. So you can observe the reference of the thread. It prints the thread name, the priority and the thread group. Remember, thread.currentThread reference returns a reference of the thread as thread name. In default name is main. Since it is main thread, default name is main. Thread priority, normal priority 5, and thread group main. If you don't create any thread group, all threads will be part of the main group. Now I have changed the name in my program. I would change the name to demo thread. So after that, it is printing demo thread. So this is regarding a reference to the main thread. Next, already told you there are two ways to create a thread. So first thread is, so first way is extending thread class. Second way is implementing runnable. So to implement runnable, actually you have to create a class similarly to the previous class. In the previous program I wrote class name extends thread. Here you have to write implements runnable. Next you have to use the second constructor. While discussing construct, told the second constructor, you have to use this constructor. Why? Because you are creating a class that implements the runnable interface. That class you have to pass as a parameter to the class. Then issue the run method on it. So whenever if you write thread.start, run method will be invoked. Actually, the start method is a part of thread class. So you have to create this constructor, thread of runnable object, comma, string thread name. I will illustrate with the help of a program. Same program I will modify. I'll take that program. Thread demo one. I'll modify the same program. I'll take the same program. I'll copy the code. I'll name it as thread demo 2. So instead of writing extends thread, now you need to write implements runnable. Instead of writing extends thread, you have to write implements runnable. Same public void run, the same code, but here you have to use for example, now it is thread demo 2, new space thread demo 2. You have to use, for example, you have to call the start method. You have to create a thread object. And you have to use, you have to pass this runnable object parameter to it. This is the only difference. You have to add this additional statement. Remaining everything is same, right? T1.start. See, the start method is a part of thread. So to the thread class, you have to pass the class that implements runnable. See, thread demo to implements runnable. So I created an object for thread demo. That object that implements runnable interface is passed to the parameter to the thread. That's the only difference. Next, I have to use t1.start. So whenever I write t1.start, automatically the control will be placed into the run and it will wait for the JVM, and the thread waits for the JVM for the process to be given to it so that it can execute. So now I will save it as thread demo 2.java. Java C space thread demo 2.java. Java space thread demo 2. See, it is running. Here only simple two things. Instead of writing extends thread, you have to write implements runnable, and you have to use the appropriate constructor. Appropriate constructor is thread of runnable object. If you want to give thread name, you can give comma thread name as well. Remember, always whenever you want to start a thread, you have to invoke the thread start method. So hence, to the thread class, we need to pass a class that implements runnable interface. So thread demo to implements runnable interface, thread demo to implements runnable. So you have to pass it thread demo to object. Here the thread demo to object name is thread demo. I have passed it as a parameter to thread constructor. Then I have invoked start method. This is another way of creating the thread. So there are two ways, using extends thread and implements runnable. So which method you have to use? So why there are two methods? See, actually, you know, Java doesn't support multiple inheritance. That is, you cannot write class A extends B comma C. A single class cannot extend from more than one class. So what if I want to create a class that uses the behavior of another class and must have multi-threading in it. Then you have to write class, class name, extends, another class name, implements run number. Why? Because you cannot write extends another class name comma thread. That is one purpose. Another purpose is in Java, in general, we'll be writing extend class name only if you want to enhance the features of an existing class. So whenever you want to add some additional behavior to an existing class, then only you have to use extends thread. In remaining all cases, you have to write implement runnable, implements runnable. So it is always recommended to implement the runnable interface. Until and unless you are not extending the behavior or using the behavior of an existing class, it is not suggestible to use the extends keyword. So hence he has given the two ways. If you are enhancing the features of an existing class, then you cannot write extends class name comma thread. Maybe because multiple inheritance is not supported by Java. That's why it's provided implements runnable interface. Always it is recommended or suggestible to use implements runnable. Until and unless you are enhancing the features of an existing class, you should not use extends keyword. So already have seen how to create a single thread. In the previous case, I created only single thread. But how will you create multiple threads? Multi-threading means more than one thread can be run. So how will you create multiple threads means same program I will modify. See, in the previous case, I directly wrote thread is running. Why? Because there is only one thread that is being run. I will modify it to, for example, I will modify the same code and you will understand. For example, here along with thread is running, I'll print the current thread name. You know, the current thread name can be printed by using thread dot current thread dot get name. So in this case, I want to run multiple threads at a time. I'll write multi thread. So whenever I want to run multiple threads at a time, so what I need to do means just simply I'm printing along with thread is running, I'm printing the thread name. So since I am creating multiple threads, each thread need to have its own name. So thread dot current thread returns a reference to thread dot current thread. Current thread is a method. Thread dot current thread returns a reference to current thread that is being run by the operating system, and its get name returns the name of the thread. So now I'll create an object to this multi-thread space empty equal to new space multi-thread. So now I have to create multiple threads. So the threads must be distinguished by the names. So what I'll be doing is, along with the runnable object, I'll be passing the thread name. For example, first thread. This is the constructor. In the previous case, I wrote till only runnable object. Multi-thread implements runnable. Along with that runnable object, I'm passing the thread name. Like that, I can create multiple threads. Thread T2. This is my second thread. Thread T3. This is my third thread. Now I have to start the threads. T1 dot start, T2 dot start, and T3 dot start. Now in total there are 4 threads for this program. I'll save it as multithread.java. Now this has total 4 threads. First thread is the main thread. Always remember, if you don't write any if you don't create any threads in your program, by default it will have one thread, that is main thread. Along with the main thread, I am scheduling three more threads. Whenever I create an object to thread class or implement runnable interface, a new thread will be created. So a thread need to be started, or a thread can run only if I call it start method. So a total four threads are there. If you want, you can induce a delay. I have already told you to illustrate multi-threading in a much better fashion, you have to induce a delay. Delay can be induced by calling thread.sleep method. It throws a checked exception, interrupted exception. So I save this program and I'll execute it. Java C space multi-thread.java. I'll execute it. Java space. Multi-thread. For example, here observe in the previous case, I used to have only one thread. See, it is printing. Third thread is running one, second thread is running one, third thread is running one, first thread is running three, like that. It is printing. See, like that. If you observe, the different threads are switching with each other and they are displaying the value from 1 to 100. Some always the order of execution may change between system to system, but the three threads will switch between each other and they execute concurrently, hence the name multi-threading. As you can observe, all the threads execute parallelly or concurrently. This is how you can create multiple threads. So which thread to be executed when will be decided by the thread scheduler or by the JVM, Java Virtual Machine. It is not under programmer's control. It is always decided by the JVM. Always, multi-threading is illustrated in the concept of single processor systems. Whenever a thread need to be executed, it need to be brought into the primary memory by the JVM, then only it can be executed. So this is regarding multi-threading concept. This is how you will create multiple threads. Threads can be created by using extends thread class or implements runnable interface. Thank you.